Hello all. So let's discuss about now the gout. What is gout and what are the drugs we use for the treatment of gout? Okay. Now what is gout? Gout means hyperuricemia. Okay. In one word, gout means hyperuricemia. It means inside the blood there is increase in uric acid level. Okay. There is increase in uric acid level in the blood. Now, why there is an increase? This increase in uric acid level in the blood can produce various complications. If this uric acid goes out of the blood vessel and deposit in joints, it leads to arthritis, which is known as gouty arthritis. And the most common joint which is involved is the first distal metatarsophalangeal joint or MTP joint. Metatarsophalangeal joint. Similarly, if it gets deposited in subcutaneous tissue, ligaments and tendons, it can produce severe pain, which is known as tophi, which is known as tophi. And similarly, if it is excreted out through kidney, it may deposit in urinary tract, which can lead to uric acid stones. It can lead to uric acid stones or nephrolithiasis. So these are the certain complications of increase in uric acid level inside the blood. Okay. Now the basic question arises, why there is increase in uric acid level in the blood? The increase in uric acid level in the blood, either it is due to overproduction inside the liver. Overproduction occurs in liver. Okay. Or it is due to under secretion, okay? Or it is due to under excretion through kidney into the urine. That means this uric acid is not getting excreted out in urine. So there are two main causes of hyperuricemia or gout, either under excretion or overproduction. So that we will be discussing that how gout level of uric acid is produced, how excessive level of uric acid is produced, and how it is excreted out in urine through kidney. So the cause of hyperuricemia is imbalance, or you can write overproduction in liver or under excretion through kidney. Now first let's see what is the management of gout. So first let's see what is the management of gout. Then we will be discussing about its pathophysiology. Okay, management. Now, if a patient of gout comes to you, if the patient of gouts come to you, what we have to do? First, we have to treat the acute gout. If a patient comes to you with acute gout attack, okay, if the patient comes to you with acute gout attack, what we have to do? We have to treat and prevent the symptoms. We have to treat and prevent the symptoms. Why we want to prevent? So that again the gout attack should not occur. Okay, now the point is during an acute attack of gout, there is inflammation. Okay, there is inflammation of joints, and the patient mainly comes to you with arthritis. This is the main symptom. Hence, for the treatment of acute attack of gout, remember we give the drugs anti-inflammatory drugs. Hence, the treatment for treatment and prevention. The drugs are anti-inflammatory. So anti-inflammatory drugs are given for the treatment of acute attack of the gout, and they are also given for prevention of symptoms of further attack. Now in long-term cases, the second goal is what is chronic gout? Chronic gout is, that means the patient is having excessive level of uric acid in the blood. So in chronic gout, the main treatment goal is to reduce uric acid deposition, or you can write uric acid level in blood. So we have to reduce the uric acid level in the blood for the treatment of chronic gout. Okay, so for acute attack of gout, we have to reduce the inflammatory symptoms, inflammation like pain, fever, redness, okay, and joint pain. And in chronic gout, we have to reduce the level of uric acid in the blood. Now let's see first what are the drugs we have for acute attack of gout. Okay, so let's see first what are the drugs we have for the acute attack of gout. For the drugs for acute attack of gout are known as anti-inflammatory drugs. Now remember, there are three class of drug. The first drug we have, which is considered as a drug of choice for acute attack of gout, both for treatment and prevention of symptoms, that is NSAIDs. NSAIDs are considered as a drug of choice for acute attack of gout for both treatment and prophylaxis of further attacks. Okay, now we can use variety of NSAIDs. NSAID stands for non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. That is non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. Examples are PIND. These are the very most commonly used NSAIDs. So you can give piroxicam, indomethacin, naproxen, diclofenac, etc. Other NSAIDs can also be used. But remember, there are certain NSAIDs which are not effective, which should not be given. Certain NSAIDs, they are not given in acute attack of gout. They are, we will write, those NSAIDs are PATPAT. Okay. The first is, we will write paracetamol. Because why paracetamol and NSAID should not be given in acute attack of gout? Because paracetamol has no anti-inflammatory property. It does not have any anti-inflammatory property. Hence, paracetamol should not be given in acute attack of gout. No anti-inflammatory property. Okay. Now, the next one we have is aspirin. Aspirin is also not given in acute attack of gout because aspirin increases uric acid level. So, we don't want to increase uric acid level in acute attack. And similarly with tolmitine. So, these three NSAIDs should not be given in gouty arthritis. Okay, the first one, paracetamol, is not effective. Aspirin and tolmitine may rather increase the level of uric acid. So, they should not be given. Okay, now the point is, in NSAID resistant cases, if there is no response to NSAIDs, that means no response, then the second drug which we can use in resistant cases is colchicine. Okay. But remember, the drug of choice for acute attack is always NSAIDs. Why? Because as compared to colchicine, they are much safer drug. Okay. Now, what is colchicine? Remember, colchicine is also given for treatment and prophylaxis of gout, so that further attacks should not occur. Okay. And this colchicine, although it is not the drug of choice, why? Because it is unsafe drug. It's an unsafe drug as compared to NSAID. But the point is, why it is given in non-responsive cases of NSAID? Because colchicine is the most effective drug for acute attack of gout we have. It is the most effective drug we have for acute attack of gout. Now the point is, what is colchicine and what is the mechanism of action? How colchicine acts as an anti-inflammatory drug? Remember, colchicine is a microtubule inhibitor. It's a microtubule inhibitor, just like an anti-cancer drug Vinca. Just like an anti-cancer drug Vinca alkaloids, it's a microtubule inhibitor. Because of this reason, microtubule inhibitor, remember, microtubule is a part of cytoskeletal. Microtubules are the proteins made up of tubulin protein. They help in cell movement or the movement of neutrophil. Suppose here we want to do inflammation in the joint. So neutrophil must migrate to this joint, and neutrophil migrates due to presence of microtubule. Microtubule are considered as a skeletal of neutrophil or cytoskeletal. So it's a microtubule inhibitor. The main mechanism of action, how it is anti-inflammatory, is it inhibits neutrophilic migration. Okay, it inhibits the migration of neutrophils to the site of inflammation. Hence, neutrophil will not migrate and inflammation will not occur. It also inhibits release of inflammatory mediators. It also inhibits the release of inflammatory mediators from this neutrophils or WBC. Okay, so try to remember that they inhibit the migration of WBCs like neutrophil. Now, because of this reason, this colchicine acts as an anti-inflammatory drug. Now, what is the route of administration? The only route of administration of colchicine is oral. There is no other route. Okay, only oral we give. What are the uses of colchicine? So we know that colchicine is the most effective drug we have for acute attack of gout, both for treatment and prophylaxis of further attack. Okay, and in gout, remember, it is the fastest acting drug we have. Fastest plus most effective drug for acute attack of gout we have. But the drug of choice is NSAIDs. Now, apart from this, it is also given in other inflammatory condition. One more in inflammatory conditions is familial Mediterranean fever. So colchicine is also given in familial Mediterranean fever. Remember, it's a type of amyloidosis. Why? Because it is seen in chronic inflammatory conditions. And the third point, we will write that colchicine is also given during karyotyping. It is also given during karyotyping. Why? Because in karyotyping, when the cell is dividing, by spindle fibers. These spindle fibers are made up of microtubule. The spindles are made up of microtubule. As we know that colchicine is a microtubule inhibitor, this cell division will arrest in between. So, cell division will arrest in between. So, it generally causes metaphase arrest. So, any microtubule inhibitor generally causes metaphase arrest. And if there is metaphase arrest, you can easily count the number of chromosomes. You can easily count the number of chromosome, and you can easily see the morphology of chromosome also. Hence, it is given in the diagnostic procedure known as karyotyping. Okay. Now, let's see what are the side effects of colchicine we know. The most common side effect of colchicine is GIT upset. Now, the point is why? Because in all GIT cells, all the mucosal cells of GIT, they are very rapidly dividing cell. For the cell division, you need microtubule protein, and colchicine inhibit microtubule, hence there will be mucosal damage. So GIT mucosal cell will get damaged. So the most common side effect of colchicine is GIT cell damage. So these include, we will write, dyspepsia, stomatitis, diarrhea. Okay, diarrhea. So these are the most common side effect. Now the most dangerous side effect, or the most dangerous side effect is, we know that the cells of bone marrow are also very rapidly dividing cell. So colchicine causes bone marrow suppression. So it inhibit any rapidly dividing cell because cell division requires microtubule. Okay, so it leads to bone marrow suppression. Now one important point we have to remember, that colchicine can be given in renal failure. Colchicine can be given in renal failure because gout mainly occurs in cases of renal failure also, because of under excretion of uric acid from the kidney. Okay, so colchicine can safely be given in renal failure. Now the third class of drug we have among acute attack of gout is corticosteroid. So the third class of drug we have is corticosteroid. So for acute attack, we give NSAIDs. Not responsive, we give colchicine. And if still no response, we can give corticosteroid. Okay. Now the point we have to remember, that corticosteroid should only be given, it should only be given for treatment of acute gout. Remember, they are not given for prophylaxis. Corticosteroids are not given for prophylaxis because in long term, corticosteroid may cause Cushing syndrome. So they are given only for acute attack of gout, for acute treatment. Okay. while NSAIDs and colchicine can be given for treatment as well as prevention. Now the point is, what is the route of administration of corticosteroid we can employ in treatment of gout? The most common method is we can give directly into the joints. So we can give intra-articular injection of corticosteroid into the joints, okay? And it is given in colchicine resistant cases, intra-articular injection, okay? This is the most common route we must employ. Sometimes we can also give oral corticosteroid also. Oral corticosteroid is only reserved in cases of patient who are having peptic ulcers due to NSAIDs and colchicine. Okay, NSAIDs and colchicine, they both may cause peptic ulcer. In those cases, there is a chance of perforation. So we reserve this oral corticosteroid in those cases, and it can be given in cases of renal failure also. In severe renal failure, we can give oral corticosteroid as a reserve drug. Now let's see what are the drugs we have for chronic gout. Okay, drugs for chronic gout patient. Now what is the main principle or the treatment goal of chronic gout? In chronic gout, we have to reduce uric acid level in the blood. Okay, we have to reduce uric acid level in the blood. Now let's see how we can reduce. Suppose this is the blood, and in blood we have uric acid. Now the point is, this uric acid can move out of the blood vessel and it can cause various tissue damage, which we have already written, like gouty arthritis, etc. So let's see how this uric acid is formed and how it is normally excreted out of our body. Okay, how uric acid is formed? Remember, uric acid is formed from purines. Uric acid is formed from purines inside the liver. Okay, now which purine we will write? There is a product of purine known as xanthine. This xanthine from the blood goes to the liver, and this xanthine is acted upon by an enzyme known as xanthine oxidase. Okay, xanthine oxidase. So inside the liver, this xanthine oxidase converts xanthine into uric acid, and uric acid comes into the blood. Now normally what happens, this uric acid goes into the kidney. It goes into the kidney. Let's say it is a nephron of the kidney. Okay. So this is the PCT, proximal convoluted tubule, PCT, proximal convoluted tubule, loop of Henle, ascending loop of Henle, etc., collecting duct. Normally this uric acid, it gets filtered from glomerulus. It gets excreted out into the urine. Okay. But remember, in our PCT, there is a transporter known as OAT transporter, that is full form we will discuss, or urate transporter, urate 1 transporter. What this transporters will do, this transporter will pick up this uric acid, and through this uric transporter, this uric acid can be reabsorbed from PCT back to the blood. Okay, so this uric acid from the PCT of the kidney, it can come again back into the blood by OAT or urate 1 transporter. Both are one, both are same thing. What is OAT stands for? OAT stands for organic anion transporter. Okay, organic anion transporter. Urate stands for uric acid transporter. So this transporter brings back uric acid back into the blood from PCT of the kidney, proximal convoluted tubule. Okay, now let's see how we can reduce this uric acid level in the blood. So we have three classes of drugs which can be given for the treatment of acute gout. Okay, so we have three classes of drug. So the first class of drugs we have is xanthine oxidase inhibitor. Okay, So first class of drug we have is xanthine oxidase inhibitor. So xanthine oxidase inhibitor will inhibit the synthesis of uric acid from xanthine. Okay, the second class of drug we have, that drug will convert uric acid into a very water soluble molecule so that it cannot be deposited in tissues. So the second class of drug we have is uric acid oxidase enzymes. Uric acid oxidase enzymes. What does these drugs will do? These drugs inside the blood, they will convert uric acid into allantoin. Allantoin is a water soluble molecule or ionic molecule, and this allantoin will simply be excreted out into the kidney. It cannot be deposited in the tissues. And the third drug we have is the drug which will inhibit this OAT transporter or urate transporter, so that this uric acid will be straight away excreted out in urine. It cannot be reabsorbed back into the blood. So these drugs, they will promote the excretion of uric acid into the urine. These drugs are known as uricose, uric agents. Okay, uricose, uric agent. So the third class of drug will be uricose, uric agent. What they will be doing? They will be inhibiting OAT or urate 1 transporter. Okay, so that uric acid should be excreted out in urine. So these are the three drug classes of drugs we have for acute chronic gout, which can reduce blood uric acid level. So let's start with the first one, that is xanthine oxidase inhibitors. Okay, xanthine oxidase inhibitor. So we will make a heading, xanthine oxidase inhibitors. Okay, so the drugs we have among xanthine oxidase inhibitors are three. The first drug we have is allopurinol. Second drug we have is oxypurinol. Okay, very famous drug. And the new drug we have is febuxostat. Febuxostat. How we can remember febuxostat? Exo word is coming. Exo means xanthine oxidase. Stat means it is suppressing or inhibiting xanthine oxidase enzyme. Okay. Now, what is their main mechanism of action? These drugs, they inhibit the conversion of xanthine into uric acid, which occurs in liver. So they inhibit this conversion of xanthine into uric acid inside the liver. Okay. Now let's see what is the difference between these drugs. So let's start with the first drug, that is allopurinol. Allopurinol. Okay. Now this allopurinol is an active drug. Okay. And its metabolite is oxypurinol. Oxypurinol is the active metabolite of allopurinol. That means allopurinol in our body can directly inhibit xanthine oxidase enzyme, and it gets converted into oxypurinol in our body, and oxypurinol also inhibit xanthine oxidase enzyme in our body. Remember, oxypurinol is also known as alloxanthine. It is also known as alloxanthine. Okay. Now let's see in which fashion it inhibits. Remember, allopurinol, it is a fake purine structure. It has a fake purine structure like xanthine. Like xanthine. And we know xanthine is a met substrate of xanthine oxidase enzyme. Because of this reason, allopurinol is a competitive. It will compete with xanthine enzyme. Xanthine, it's a competitive inhibitor of xanthine oxidase enzyme. Okay, it's a competitive inhibitor of xanthine oxidase enzyme. So it has a purine. It's a purine structure just like xanthine, but fake. Hence, it's a competitive inhibitor of xanthine oxidase. But remember, in low dose. in low dose. If you will increase the dose higher, in high dose, allopurinol becomes a non-competitive inhibitor. It becomes a non-competitive inhibitor of xanthine oxidase enzyme. Okay, so allopurinol and oxypurinol in low dose, they are competitive inhibitor, but in high dose they become non-competitive inhibitor. Now, what is the route of administration? These drugs, they can be given both orally as well as by injections. Okay, injections. Now let's see uses. Okay, now this allopurinol is the drug of choice for chronic gout. Okay, the drug of choice for chronic gout is allopurinol. Okay, so remember this part. Now let's see what are the different causes of chronic gout, why there is increase in level of uric acid. Okay, so in chronic gout we will reduce the level of uric acid and the drug of choice is allopurinol, but remember allopurinol is contraindicated in acute gout. In acute gout we don't give allopurinol. Why? Because in acute gout we don't reduce the level of uric acid level in the blood. Okay, in acute attack of gout we don't reduce the level of uric acid. Why? Uric acid itself is an anti-inflammatory molecule, so we don't want to reduce the level of uric acid in acute attack. Okay, now let's see what are the different causes of increase in uric acid level. Okay, what are the cause? So let's see the causes of increase in uric acid level. Okay, the first cause is overproduction. Second cause is under excretion from kidney. So the first cause of chronic gout or increase in uric acid level is overproduction. Now why there is overproduction? There could be some genetic disease in which there is excessive production of purines like Lish-Nyhan syndrome. In Lish-Nyhan syndrome, there is excessive production of guanine. Okay, Lish-Nyhan syndrome. Okay, there could be other reasons also in which the level of uric acid may increase, like we will write glucose 6 phosphatase deficiency. Okay, in Lish-Nyhan syndrome there is HGPRTH deficiency, hypoxanthine guanine phosphoribosyl transferase. Okay, glucose 6 phosphatase deficiency, also known as von Guericke disease. Okay, now there could be other causes like we will write tumor lysis syndrome. In tumor lysis syndrome, what happens? It happens due to anti-cancer drug. When we give anti-cancer drug in tumors like lymphomas, there is rapid killing of cells, and rapid killing of cells will lead to DNA destruction. DNA will release purine into the blood, and these purines will go to the liver and will be converted into uric acid. Hence, when we give anti-cancer drug to the patient of cancer, they suffer from gout. Okay, so they suffer from gout very commonly. Okay, now similarly, if we talk about the causes of under excretion, the causes of under excretion is renal failure. Okay, renal failure. We can write excessive alcohol consumption. And third, we can write is drugs. Okay, so the drugs which can inhibit the excretion of uric acid into the blood, we can write NSAIDs like aspirin or salicylates. We will write anti-diuretics like lupentiazides. Third, we can write some anti-tuberculosis drug like pyrazinamide and ethambutol. pyrazinamide and ethambutol, they are very commonly implicated in causing gout. Okay, now remember, in all these conditions, the drug of choice is allopurinol. The drug of choice in all these conditions is allopurinol, except tumor lysis syndrome. In tumor lysis syndrome, the better answer is, the drug we will be discussing is rusfuricase. That will be the second drug, and which is a better drug as compared to allopurinol. So the only exception you must remember is tumor lysis syndrome. In tumor lysis syndrome, the drug of choice is rusfuricase. It's a uric acid oxidase enzyme. Okay, uric acid. Similarly, we will write what are the other uses of allopurinol. Okay, other uses of allopurinol. We'll write allopurinol is also given for urate, stones, or nephrolithiasis. Okay, nephrolithiasis due to uric acid stone, because it will reduce the production. Similarly, second point we will write, it is also given, it was developed as a drug for Kala Azar. Allopurinol was developed not for the gout, it was developed for Kala Azar. So it has anti-protozoal activity. Anti-protozoa, which protozoa causes Kala Azar? We know it is caused by Leishmania. It has anti-leishmanial effect. Leishmania species. Okay, so these are the other uses of allopurinol. Now let's see what are the side effects and contraindications of allopurinol. The most common side effect of allopurinol is hypersensitivity. The most common side effect of allopurinol is hypersensitivity. It causes rashes. Okay, most commonly rashes. It may also cause, this is the most common side effect, it may also cause an allergic or hypersensitive condition known as Stevens-Johnson syndrome. Okay, Stevens-Johnson syndrome. And the most dangerous side effect of allopurinol is bone marrow suppression. It may cause bone marrow suppression. Rarely, the rare side effects of, or less common side effects of allopurinol is, it is hepatotoxic. It may damage liver. It may also cause cataracts. Okay, it may also cause cataract. These are the rare side effects of allopurinol. Now just remember, allopurinol is absolutely contraindicated in pregnancy. And it is absolutely contraindicated during breastfeeding, lactation. Allopurinol is absolutely contraindicated. Okay, now let's talk about the new congener of allopurinol we made. That next drug is febuxostat. Another xanthine oxidase inhibitor is febuxostat. Now let's see how febuxostat is different from allopurinol. Febuxostat is a rather. Allopurinol was a purine derivative. Febuxostat is a non-purine derivative. It is not a fake purine. It is a non-purine derivative, and it is a non-competitive inhibitor of, it's a non-competitive inhibitor of xanthine oxidase. While allopurinol was a purine derivative and it was a competitive inhibitor of xanthine oxidase at a normal dose or low dose. Okay, so remember this part. Febuxostat. The advantage is that febuxostat can be given if there is hypersensitivity to allopurinol. If there is hypersensitivity to allopurinol, we can give febuxostat. Remember, if allopurinol produces hypersensitivity, it's an indication to stop allopurinol. And you can start febuxostat. Okay? If allopurinol produces toxicity, you must stop it. Okay? Now, let's talk about certain drug interactions of allopurinol. Drug interactions of allopurinol. Now, allopurinol, remember first point, that allopurinol itself is an enzyme inhibitor. It's an enzyme inhibitor. It inhibits variety of CYP enzymes inside the liver. Now the point is, as CYP stands for cytochrome P enzyme, cytochrome P enzyme is responsible for degradation of various drugs in our body. Hence, it can lead to toxicity of the drugs like theophylline. It is an anti-asthma drug. So allopurinol can cause theophylline toxicity. It can cause warfarin toxicity. It can cause warfarin toxicity. Warfarin. तो वॉरफरिन टॉक्सिसिटी कैन लीड टू एक्सेसिव ब्लीडिंग, ओके, एंड इट कैन लीड टू साइक्लोफॉस्फामाइड टॉक्सिसिटी लाइक बोन मैरो सप्रेशन. साइक्लोफॉस्फामाइड इज एन एंटी कैंसर ड्रग, ओके, सो रिमेंबर दिस पॉइंट. नाउ द पॉइंट इज, दिस एलोप्यूरिनॉल ऑल्सो इनहिबिट जैंथिन ऑक्सीडेज एंजाइम दैट वी नो. नाउ द पॉइंट इज, देर आर टू ड्रग्स विच आर डिग्रेडेड इन अवर बॉडी by xanthine oxidase enzyme, and allopurinol inhibits xanthine oxidase. Remember, these drugs are 6-mercaptopurine, so it is also a fake purine, 6-mercaptopurine and its prodrug, that is azathioprine. These two drugs, they are degraded in our body by an enzyme, xanthine oxidase enzyme. Now the point is, allopurinol generally inhibits xanthine oxidase enzyme. Because of this reason, the level of 6-mercaptopurine and azathioprine may increase, and hence it may also lead to toxicity of these two drugs, which can lead to dangerous bone marrow suppression. So when allopurinol is combined with this drug, it can lead to dangerous bone marrow suppression. These two are also fake purine drug. Because of this reason, if you are combining these drugs with allopurinol, you have to reduce the dose of these drug by 25%. You have to reduce the drug dose of these drug by 25%. That means, initially if you are giving the dose of 100 milligram, now you will be giving the dose of 25 milligram only, okay? So reduce their dose to 1/4 level, okay? So remember this part. Now let's talk about the next class of drug, that is uric acid oxidase enzyme. Okay, uric acid oxidase enzyme. These drugs are also known as uricase. There are two drugs. The first drug we will write is ruspuricase. Okay, so any enzyme, it will end with the word ase, remember. And the second drug we have is pegloticase. Pegloticase. Ase word is coming again. Now, what is the mechanism of action of these drugs? These drugs, they will go into the blood and they will directly convert uric acid into allantoin. Now allantoin is such a water soluble molecule that this allantoin cannot deposit in tissues like joints and etc. And this allantoin is rapidly excreted out in urine. It is such a water soluble or ionic molecule that it cannot deposit anywhere, and it is non-toxic. Ionic and non-toxic, unlike uric acid. Okay? Now, if you talk about these two drugs, pegloticase, okay, and ruspuricase. This ruspuricase is an enzyme which is obtained from birds. Okay, it is obtained from birds. And this pegloticase is obtained from mammals. Okay, ruspuricase is obtained from birds. It's an enzyme present in the birds and it is present in mammals. Now, what are the side effects of these drugs? First, we will write. So, if you are using these enzymes of other animals and giving in humans, their most common and most dangerous side effect is hypersensitivity. Because you are using the enzymes or proteins of other animals in human. Okay? Hypersensitivity. which could be severe allergic reaction. Okay, and in long term, what will happen? Our body will try to form antibodies against them. So there will be formation of autoantibodies, and these autoantibodies will reduce their effect. If you are using them again and again, there in long term their effect will be reduced, because the body will try to produce autoantibodies. And remember, these drugs are contraindicated in G6PD enzyme deficiency. These drugs are contraindicated in G6PD because it can lead to hemolysis, severe hemolysis. Okay, now if you talk about these two drugs, among them they both have common side effect and contraindication, but this pegloticase is much safer drug because it is more of a mammal species. Okay, pegloticase is much safer. Because of this reason, let's see what are the uses of these drugs. If you talk about uses, this pegloticase and respuricase, better drug is pegloticase. They are the drug of choice for tumor lysis syndrome. Okay, they are the drug of choice for tumor lysis syndrome, and they are also the drug of choice for allopurinol resistant cases. Okay, so in resistant cases we use these drugs. Now the last class of drug which is used in the treatment of chronic gout are uric agents. Okay, now uric agent, remember, they promote excretion of uric acid into the urine. That is why they got their word uric agent. Uricose means promoting action in urine of uric acid. How? By inhibiting, they inhibit reabsorption of uric acid back to blood from PCT, proximal convoluted tubule of kidney. Now why? Because there was a transporter known as OAT, organic anion transporter, or urate 1 transporter, which is responsible for reabsorption back into the blood. Okay, now the point is, as you are promoting the excretion of uric acid into the nephron, from the nephron into the urine, as this uric acid is excreted out in urine, remember, it can deposit anywhere in this urinary tract, uric acid, and it can lead to uric acid stones. So what is the common side effect of these drugs? These drugs, they can cause uric acid stones in kidney, ureter, etc., which is also known as nephrolithiasis. If this uric acid will deposit anywhere in between, it can lead to stones, nephrolithiasis. Okay, because of this reason, remember, to prevent this nephrolithiasis, you have to give patient should have liberal fluid intake. When you are using this drug, a patient should take plenty of fluid so that this uric acid should not be deposited anywhere in this urinary tract. Okay, otherwise it can lead to uric acid stones. Okay, so remember this part. So if a patient comes to you with uric acid stone, remember, these drugs should not be given. So let's see what are the drugs we have among uric agents. So let's talk about drugs. The drugs are, there are four drugs: probenecid, uric agent. Second drug we have is benzbromarone. We have lesinurad, a new drug. And lastly, sulfapyrazone. So these are the four drugs which are approved. Now, the most commonly used drug is probenecid. Okay. Now, let's see first point, what is the status of probenecid? Okay. Now, probenecid is generally given as an add-on drug. Okay. In allopurinol to allopurinol. It is given as an add-on drug to allopurinol. Okay. And it is also given as an add-on drug to colchicine also. So it is not available singly. It is given as an add-on drug to allopurinol or colchicine. Okay. Now, what is the most common side effect of probenecid? The most common side effect of probenecid is GIT upset. Just like colchicine, it causes dyspepsia and diarrhea. Okay. Benzbromarone. One great advantage of benzbromarone is that benzbromarone is absolutely safe in renal failure. If there is renal failure, we can give benzbromarone. Okay, but remember, probenecid is contraindicated in renal failure, and rest all other drugs are also contraindicated in renal failure. So the only safe drug we have in renal failure among them is benzbromarone. Okay. What is the main side effect of benzbromarone? The main side effect of benzbromarone, we will write that benzbromarone is hepatotoxic. Benzbromarone is hepatotoxic. Lesinurad is a new drug. Okay. Lesinurad. And it is given orally. In orally, when it is given, lesinurad has 100% oral bioavailability. It is completely absorbed. And what is the use? The use is same like probenecid. It is also given as an add-on drug to allopurinol. It is also given as an add-on drug to allopurinol. And lastly, we have a sulfenpyrazone. Sulfenpyrazone, it has additional antiplatelet effect. It has additional antiplatelet effect also. Okay. Now, before going further, let's see the drug interactions of probenecid. Drug interactions of probenecid. Okay. Now, the point is, we know that probenecid is inhibiting OAT transporter in PCT of kidney. Okay, suppose this is a proximal convoluted tubule of kidney, and this proximal convoluted tubule of kidney, it has OAT transporter, organic anion transporter. Now remember, this transporter is a bidirectional transporter. This transporter is bidirectional. Bidirectional means that certain substances from the blood may come into the urine, into the kidney, and will be excreted out in urine. And certain substances from the kidney may come back into the blood. Okay. So some things from the blood will go in, some drugs from the blood may go into the urine, into the kidney. And certain molecules or the drugs may come back into the blood from the kidney. So it's a bidirectional transporter. And we know that probenecid inhibit this transporter. Because of this reason, there could be certain drugs which are dependent upon OAT, their level may increase or decrease. So let's see what are the different drug interactions of probenecid. What are the different drug interactions? Okay. Now, the first class of drug which are present in the blood, which are dependent upon OAT transporter to be excreted out in urine. Okay. So, if we inhibit this OAT transporter, can we say that probenecid will reduce urinary excretion of these drugs? Probenecid will reduce the urinary excretion of this drug because urinary excretion of this drug is dependent upon OAT transporter. Okay. And probenecid has inhibited OAT transporter. So let's see what are the different list of the drugs. So we will write PCM. ओके पीसीएम सिन. तो फर्स्ट इज पेनिसिलिन. रिमेंबर पेनिसिलिन इज एक्सक्रीटेड इन टू द यूरिन फ्रॉम द बॉडी थ्रू ओएटी ट्रांसपोर्टर. एग्जाम्पल वेरियस पेनिसिलिन्स लाइक एम्पिसिलिन एक्सेट्रा. नाउ द पॉइंट इज वी कंबाइन प्रोबेनिसिड विद पेनिसिलिन. व्हाई? बिकॉज इफ यू विल कंबाइन प्रोबेनिसिड विद पेनिसिलिन दिस पेनिसिलिन विल नॉट बी एक्सक्रीटेड आउट इन टू द यूरिन एंड द लेवल ऑफ प्रो पेनिसिलिन इन साइड द ब्लड विल इंक्रीज. To make it make this penicillin long acting, we generally combine them with probenecid. So probenecid is very routinely combined with penicillin to make it long acting, because probenecid will reduce urinary excretion of penicillin. Similarly, other drugs like cephalosporin, methotrexate. Okay, sulfonamides, indomethacin, and nitrofurantoin. Now just remember, with all these first drug except nitrofurantoin, it will increase the blood level. Okay. Now the point is there it will increase their effect. It will increase the effect. So probenecid will increase the effect of penicillin, cephalosporin, methotrexate, sulfonamide and indomethacin, while it will increase the blood level of nitrofurantoin, but it will reduce the effect. Why? Because this nitrofurantoin is a urinary antiseptic. To produce effect, nitrofurantoin must come into the bladder. From kidney, the nitrofurantoin must come out into the bladder and urinary antiseptic must be excreted out into the urine to produce effect in the bladder. So it must come out into the bladder and probenecid is inhibiting the excretion of nitrofurantoin. Okay. Now we will write probenecid also. Probenecid also reduce biliary excretion because in liver this OAT transporter is again present, biliary excretion of rifampicin, and because of this reason probenecid can also increase the effectiveness of rifampicin like drug also. Probenecid also reduce the biliary excretion. Now we are talking about bile. And the last point we must remember that probenecid, the drugs, if we will combine them drug with aspirin or salicylates. Remember, salicylates antagonize, they show antagonism with probenecid. Okay. Aspirin and probenecid, they should never be combined together because aspirin reduce the effect of probenecid because they both compete for same transporter. Okay, same transporter. So remember this part. Now remember, there are certain additional drugs which have uric property. There are certain additional drugs which have uricose uric property. So these drugs are good for gout patient. They are good for gout patient. So the drugs we will write is losartan. Losartan is a angiotensin 1 receptor blocker, 81 receptor blocker. It is used as an antihypertensive drug. Second drug we will write is fenofibrate. Okay, fenofibrate, it's a hypolipidemic drug. Third, we will write one statin, rosuvastatin. It also has uricose uric property. Okay, and lastly, we will write canakinumab. Canakinumab is a monoclonal antibody against that will block interleukin 1b. Okay, but right now it has not been approved for gout. Okay. So these are the additional drugs which have uricose uric property, but they are used elsewhere. They are not used for the treatment of gout. So this is all about gout. Thank you very much.